the grimy alleys and looming mansions of Arkham harbor eldritch forces, terrifying secrets, and unspeakable monsters. Within these ancient buildings, gibbering madmen and cultists call upon the Ancient Ones, who promptly press ignore, sending these calls straight to voicemail, but not for long, as these Ancient Ones must eventually answer these calls on their cellies. But the good news is that tonight, a few brave investigators venture behind Arkham's closed doors to make their stand against the madness within. This evening, we play a fully cooperative board game of horror and discovery for 1 to 5 players. Tonight on the Board Boys podcast,
Mansions of Madness!
Call the cultists back, Ancient Ones. It's the Board Boys.
I'm Campbell D'Souza.
I'm Francis Scott Key.
This is your host, Josh. Hey, everybody. Welcome to episode 5 of the Board Boys podcast. How's it going out
there? The fifth one we've done.
That was good. That was really good.
That's going to be our new theme song.
We'll just change the number every time. Yeah. Anyway, welcome to the Board Boys podcast, episode number 5. We are heading into the Mansions of Madness tonight, and guys, I got to say, I'm very excited about tonight because the guest is my beautiful wife, Samantha Ladd.
My wife.
Samantha, why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Hi, my name's Sammi. Last name, just Ladd. Apparently my husband doesn't know that because on the video they posted last week, he called me by my maiden name.
I saved it halfway through. I went, Colette.
No, you didn't.
It wasn't a good save. No. I'll give you that. Anyway, we're playing Mansions of Madness tonight, which is a cooperative board game, which I think is appropriate. After last week's episode with Ben, we effectively put a win in every category. So Campbell's won, Frank's won, I've won, and our guest has won. So we decided to switch things up a little bit tonight.
And so this week, nobody wins.
No, potentially.
Or everybody wins.
Well, but in the world of H.P. Lovecraft, nobody ever wins, right? Does anybody ever win in like H.P. Lovecraft stuff?
So I honestly can't answer that because beyond the board games, I've never really gotten into like the folklore and the backstory with H.P. Lovecraft. I do know that every time I've played this game, when I think I win, they tell us the story at the end and it's like, did I win? Did I actually win? Because it doesn't feel like I just won.
Everything I know about H.P. Lovecraft, and I have never read anything other than maybe like a couple short stories. Like it usually is like always about like the protagonists like learning stuff they shouldn't learn, and then like in the climax of the book, they like stare into like some kind of abyss, and then their mind explodes, and then they go insane, and then they die forever in like a pit of hell.
They die forever.
Yeah.
They die once, and then they just keep dying.
They just
over
die.
And
they just
over.
Die eternally.
They experience death for the rest of.
Yeah, and then they're turned entirely insane, and then like a completely unpronounceable like elder demon does something horrible.
Samantha,
what?
What's your experience with board games?
Well, in high school, me and my two best friends played a lot of Disney themed board games.
Nice.
Seen it?
Disney Seen It, Disney Sorry.
Disney Risk?
No. Disney
no.
Monopoly. I didn't play Monopoly very much because they were better than me and they didn't make it very fun.
What's your favorite game that we play?
Clank is very fun. I've never won. I always come in last.
I've
won. I have a lot of fun.
I've never won.
I've won. Do you want to tell the guys what happened when we played Clank in Space last week, 2 weeks ago?
Yeah, I was betrayed by my sister.
She really was.
If you listen to the podcast, Sammy, then you would know that I won the one and only game of Clank that I played. And there was somewhere else I was going with this.
I did listen to that episode, and I know that Campbell did not love Clank.
You know, I was a little hard on it, and I think I was thinking more just like about that specific experience, but yeah, I've actually had a lot of time to think about it in the last like 5 or 6 weeks, but I really do think Clank's a pretty good, pretty fun game.
Mm-hmm.
I just think that there's like a couple little things that decreased my enjoyment of it.
And if you want to know what those are, you can
check them out in episode two
of the Board Boys podcast.
But I would fully endorse the game for any like low-key like game night and I think I was just thinking of it more of like a strategy game, and I should have been thinking of it more as like a cool game with a great theme.
Yeah.
That, yeah.
So I don't remember if we've actually mentioned this on the podcast before or if we talked about it and it didn't make it to air or whatever, but I've never been a board game owner before because I've just lived so close to Cam and just been able to play his games. And if I ever want to go over and play a game, he's totally down to do it. So I've never really needed to you. But then just the other day, I saw a really great Cyber Week sale online and for Betrayal at Baldur's Gate, and I ordered it, was expecting to get it next week, and then on Thursday I actually went out and got my hair cut over at Franklin Barber, Beaverdale, and I got home and it was waiting on my front porch. So
have you cracked into it yet?
I have not played it just yet. I'm really pumped to get into it. It looks like a super cool game. I got it all unboxed and everything ready to roll. So
it's supposed to be great. I mean, I know a lot of people have love for Betrayal at House on... Is it Betrayal at House on the Haunted Hill or Betrayal at House on the Hill?
Betrayal at House on the Hill.
Okay, Betrayal at House on the Hill. So I know when a few years ago when I was living in Iowa before I moved up to Minneapolis, that was a game that Campbell, you and I, and Frank also, we played that game quite a bit, if memory serves correctly.
That game was instrumental in getting me into board games. And while it's not on like my top, you know, 20 fave games, I look back at it like pretty fondly. And I think that... And I have played the new... like Betrayal at Baldur's Gate, and I've played like the expansion for Betrayal at House on the Hill that came out a year or two ago, and I think that the things that they've been doing to update the game are really smart. I think that there's more attention to like thematics, which is great in a game that like is pretty light on mechanics. Mm-hmm. So cool things for both those games.
I'm also really excited. I don't know if the people listening saw, but they announced that they're going to be doing a Betrayal Legacy game, which I'm hoping is awesome. I've been having a lot of fun with Legacy games lately. So hopefully that game, which takes a title that I know may not necessarily be in our top rotation, but a game that we all have a soft spot in our heart for, and this Legacy version, then they just knock it out of the park.
There are no soft spots in my heart.
That is not true.
All. I'm like the softest dude.
Campbell's a teddy bear. Campbell's a giant teddy bear. Anyway, we are doing things a little bit differently tonight. Since Samantha is joining us, we're actually recording at my house. We normally record at Campbell's, so you may hear some dogs yipping in the background. I have two corgis, Gizmo and Barkley. We'll put a photo of them up on the internet. But if at any point through the episode you hear a dog barking, it's probably Gizmo or it's probably Barkley.
Or DMX.
Or a baby crying.
Yeah, there you go.
Or our child. Or with that, yes.
So the really great thing about recording at Josh's house is that it's a much safer street. T-Bone has nothing to say about the street that we're parked on.
Usually your car wide open. So,
yeah.
There are so many board games and a Nintendo Switch in my car right now. If somebody were to break into it, I would be super sad.
So one of the things that I constantly find myself talking about whenever Betrayal does come up is how I would rather play Mansions of Madness. I think the sort of the haunted house mechanic, the storytelling, just the features are done a little bit better in this game, which is why I prefer to play it. That being said, I'm so out of breath.
I'm glad you're out of breath because I have a rebuttal.
Go ahead.
These are like two entirely different games.
Yeah, I know.
By the way, we just took a break to like take those dogs downstairs, and Josh ran both of his fat little corgis downstairs, and they're heavy little dudes, right?
They're very heavy. They're fat little logs. They're log dogs. We call them log dogs.
They're like a log.
Barkley's a log dog.
So, Betrayal is a different game from Mansions. It like on almost every level because. Mansions of Madness has like five large scenarios, and then you can get expansions of madness to do more scenarios.
Sure.
Whereas Betrayal at House on the Hill is meant to be played in roughly an hour. You know, Mansions of Madness is a tougher game, more strategic, more exploration, more like a more story to every moment of it.
Yeah.
With robust combat, whereas Betrayal House on the Hill is like a fun time while you have a couple beers.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I was thinking through it more from the aspect of like the tile exploration, how the board kind of comes together as you play it, how you're building up a character. There's items that you can find and take advantage of throughout the game. Those certain similarities, and I think for me it's also more the theme than anything. Like it's a horror exploration style game. And so, like I said, given the choice between the two, I would generally lean towards playing Mansions. That being said, it is a longer play. It's a little bit more involved. I often describe it, and this may be a terrible description, but I often describe it as betrayal for adults, because the themes are sometimes a little bit more graphic. Like there is violence that's scattered in throughout this game, which we'll talk about. And some of the scenes that the pictures it paints can be a little bit disturbing, I would say. I mean, you're going into houses and finding cults, and they're sacrificing people and doing like weird things. So yeah, anyway.
I think it'd be interesting to see betrayal for kids.
I think that the betrayal is more like an episode of the Twilight Zone.
Sure.
And then like Mansions of Madness is more like
Xena Warrior Princess.
like a horror movie.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know, it's a very short, bite-sized, like similar thing. Mm-hmm. But it's self-contained, and there's a bunch of different ways things could go. But you always start the game the same way.
Yep. So I want to kick it over to my wife, because we've played this game a few times together. Sammi, what do you think about Mansions of Madness before we get started here?
I really like this game. I am a big fan of anything horror related or scary. So to me, this is really fun because of the music that plays along while you're playing the game. The interactive app on the iPad is really cool. And I just like how every time you play, it's something different.
Yeah. I will also add, Sammi loves the kind of game where like something like a mini game or something random happens. So like when we played
the puzzles.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Those are cool.
Do you want to talk about those?
Yeah. They have all these different kinds of puzzles that you have to beat. And some are like, you have to move blocks so that you can get a specific block out. There are like codes that you have to crack.
And these are on the iPad?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're part of the companion app.
Frank's never played this game before, and his mind is literally being blown right now.
I'm really excited to play it. Yeah.
So this game requires a companion app.
It does.
And a lot of the stuff you do, you have to manipulate the app. This is one of two games that have brilliant apps that coordinate with the game. This and Alchemist, which we'll cover really soon.
Fantasy Flight's actually been stepping up their companion app game recently. The Imperial Assault app that just came out is supposed to be incredible. The Mansions of Madness app is constantly being updated. They're adding new voice support. They're adding new functionality. I haven't played Alchemist. I know that's on the list, so we'll see that one as well. But Fantasy Flight...
I'm so pumped for Alchemist. Sorry.
I think Fantasy Flight is very much going... They acknowledge that. I think the next step for them in board games is going to be that technology physical board integration, and we're going to start to see that probably a little bit more in some of the titles that they're going to have coming out.
Sammi, have you played other like horror board games? Have you done Betrayal at House on the Hill?
Harry Potter Clue. The Twilight board game.
Oh,
nice.
No,
what's the point of the Twilight board game?
I don't think I ever played it. I think I just bought it because it was Twilight, and do we still have it?
No.
If I was to create a Twilight board game, knowing only a couple things about Twilight, never seen a movie, never read a book, it would be a team game, and you would put the girl in the middle of a board that just has two paths you can go with a number of spaces, and there would be a little cardboard like standing up cut out of the girl, and then on one end there would be like that vampire dude, a little cardboard cut out of him,
Edward.
And then the wolf dude on the other side, and then the teams just roll a six-sided dice and try to move her closer and closer to their person.
And that's probably what it was.
Every now and then there's event cards that are just like, Edward violently dumps Bella and runs away.
The Volturi are coming.
Yeah, or if you're like the wolf team, you could be like, if it's like six spaces or less away from the vampire dude, it could be like, the wolf dude isn't wearing a shirt in PE today. move seven spaces towards the wolf. Yeah.
Like Campbell said, this game does require...
Hang on. I'm so sorry. Sorry.
We're still going on this Twilight thing.
No. Where I was going with the question, I know we went on a big tangent there, but like, since you don't like play tons of board games the way we do, but you have like a special place in your heart for this one, like what are some of the things, I think, because we kind of cut you off, that you really do like about it?
Well, the app, that makes it really fun because like I said, it's different every time you play it. I like the monsters, the gangs that come after you. The tiles are really cool because it's a different board every time. Mm-hmm. Just depends on like what you and the other players decide to do.
Yeah. And the tiles are really cool looking too, and the miniatures are really nice.
Yeah, it's like all set in like 1930.
1932 is 19, the way we would say it.
1932, where everyone says, "Hey, governor."
No, this is no. not. This is an American game.
Cockney accent.
Arkham, no, Arkham is in New England.
Everyone in this game has transatlantic accents. And
oh, you mean like that? Like
it's a baby. See?
Yeah.
Dare Tilly, going to Arkham Mansion. Stop.
Yeah.
So
heard there was a missing persons case. Stop.
So before we get into the game, I am going to give you guys just a quick high-level rundown of the stats coming directly to you from Board Game Geek, like we do every episode. Mansions of Madness is currently rated 8.2 out of 10, which for an overall rank is good for number 20 on the list. If we're looking at just the theme of the game is currently ranked number 7 on that theme list. Player counts 1 to 5. It's best with 3 to 4. We're playing with 4 tonight. The play time, according to the site, is 120 to 180 minutes. I think that's a bit inaccurate, only because some of the pre-programmed stories that you can play actually go up to 300 plus minutes.
Or very accurate, depending on what you play.
Well, yeah. I mean, if you play, again, this game, it varies. It can, I think it goes the minimum length. There's a story that you can get done in 90 minutes. If you play one of the longer ones, it says that it's going to take about 5 or 6 hours to play. Age is 14 plus, and the weight is 2.63 out of 5. Again, it's a cooperative game, so I'm really looking forward to playing it tonight. Campbell, Samantha, anything that you want to tell the folks about the actual gameplay, what we're going to be doing as we take on Mansions of Madness?
Mansions of Madness is a game that is very easy to play. I mean, you don't need to teach the people you're playing with how to play it. So it's a great approachable thing for just about anybody. I mean, obviously one person there will want to be pretty familiar with the rules, but it's kind of like Betrayal at House on the Hill in that you can kind of start playing as you teach the game. So that is a really attractive thing for people who maybe would dabble in like, oh, I wish I could play Dungeons and Dragons with my friends, but like there's so much to learn and we don't have time to do this. Having played this before, this is a great game for people who want to have like an evening adventure with your friends and not have to think too much before or after. Mm-hmm. You don't have to like prepare for the game, which is cool.
You don't have to watch like a hour-long video.
Okay, first of all, Rodney is a national treasure. He's a Canadian treasure, and we would be lucky to have him here in the United States, for the record.
Rodney.
So he's an international treasure.
He's an international treasure. It's national to me.
Oh, but National Treasure 3, Nicolas Cage.
I gotta go steal Rodney.
Treasure. The hunt for Rodney.
I'm gonna steal Rodney from Canada.
The hunt for Rodney. So.
Whoa. That's Keanu.
No, that's Keanu.
So with that.
Andy Samberg impressions.
We're gonna go ahead and get
basically
started.
Basically the same.
We're gonna go ahead and get started with Mansions of Madness. We'll be back with you shortly. We are back. Holy crap. That was intense. It came down to the wire. People were dying. People were going insane. But somehow we did it. We escaped from Innsmouth. And I have never felt more accomplished in a board game probably in my entire life.
Oh, I certainly have.
Oh, I know you have.
I have too.
But same. Oh, man.
This is super anticlimactic.
Same. No way. Yeah, because you guys all died. Anyway.
No.
We just got done playing Mansions of Madness. We played the Escape from Innsmouth scenario, which is 4 out of 5 stars, 90 to 150 minutes. And I would say it probably ran us towards the longer end of that.
Yeah, definitely.
But let's get right into it. Sammi, I'm going to start with you. How do you feel about Mansions of Madness? Do you like this game? Do you hate this game? What do you think?
I like this game. Are you asking if I specifically like how the game went tonight or overall?
Both. overall, what are your thoughts? And then how did you feel about the game tonight?
Well, I mean, I think you guys know that I like this game. We talked about that a little bit, mm-hmm. how I like how it's different every time you play it.
You got to do a puzzle.
I finally got to do a puzzle. Out of all the times I've played this game, I've never been the player who gets to unlock one of the puzzles. So that was pretty fun.
The puzzles are cool.
How'd you feel about the playthrough tonight?
I think for like the first half of the game, I was really bored.
Yeah.
Because none of us had taken any damage. There were no horrors.
Horrors.
Yeah.
Horrors.
No horrors.
We were trapped in this horror house, and there was no horrors to be found.
And then just all of a sudden, I went insane, and I couldn't do anything. I had a secret objective, and
then also the thing happened with the cards where she was unable to move, do stuff
or do anything.
Yeah, I couldn't move. And
she went insane, and then all that stuff happened.
Yeah, so
it was. I'm saying it was crazy.
The player, Sammi, went insane. And
yes.
And then the character had all this stuff happen to her.
Yes.
If I could speak to this playthrough really quick, I think just to kind of double up on what Sammi said, I have had the opportunity to play this game 4 times, and if this was my first time playing the game, I might not feel like playing it again. Well, so the end was really good. Like, we played for probably 3 hours, and the last half hour of the game was really tense and everything counted, and we almost didn't make it, but we made it.
Yep.
Two of us died, and Frank's character technically didn't win also. So we just made it by the skin of our teeth. But I have played this game.
We saved the world.
Yeah, we did. I've played this game 4 times with both of you, I think, every time we've played, mm-hmm. and not Frank. But in the other 3 times we've played, the pressure has kind of always been on.
Yep.
And there's always been stuff to clean up. You kind of got to, like, wrap up your wounds. You mm-hmm. got to have somebody kind of fighting monsters the whole time, somebody like running around doing stuff. In this time, particular time we played, we had nothing going on like the entire game.
I would say, though, I think that's because we were really efficient with how the first part of the game played. Like, yeah, it did start to snowball towards the end, and we had multiple monsters that were coming up. But at the beginning, all of our dice rolls were hitting, so monsters were dying as soon as they came out onto the board. We had extra tokens that we could use to get additional moves on all of our lockboxes, so we weren't having to take multiple turns. I mean, we did it in your case, but I think in both Sammi and I's case, those puzzles, which are normally supposed to take, you know, 2 to 3 turns, we were able to get that done in 1 turn. So it wasn't necessarily a matter of the game was playing slow. I mean, yes, that is a byproduct, but I think it was more, we were just being really efficient with what we were doing. We were moving around the board. We were talking to people. We were killing monsters as soon as they came up. And so it didn't really seem like we were doing a whole lot, but we were doing a really good job of managing the town that we were moving into. There did come a point when one of the larger creatures came back out in full force and then started spawning additional monsters, that things started to get crazy, because then parts of the town started to get lit on fire. We started to get separated. We were at that point trying to move around. And I think that's where a lot of the pressure and some of the stress from the previous playthroughs that we had done started to come back up. But I was actually really proud of us for the first probably hour and a half that we were playing the game, because we were just playing so well. And yeah, unfortunately, a byproduct is if you're doing great in a game that's supposed to be really stressful, you don't feel the stress, so it doesn't feel like a lot's happening. But I'd rather have that, because that set the foundation for us to finally beat the with.
And this is one of the harder. We played one of the harder. One of the harder.
It's the second hardest one. Yeah. If we would have played the 2-star hour long game, we would have crushed that no problem. But we came into the second hardest difficulty scenario that we've never beat before. That the last time we played it, we spent like 3.5 hours and got crushed at the very end, and we beat it. And I think that a lot of that is because we were so efficient and moving things around at the beginning of the game, that when it did start to snowball, it didn't hit us as hard as the first time that we played it.
We did. We came in guns blazing. Mm-hmm. Like, first monster, attacked him. But I think if we wouldn't have been focusing so much on attacking the monsters and maybe interacting with the people that were on the board, we could have gotten there a lot faster. Because we wouldn't have had to wait till the end to talk to the agent to figure out then that he moves all the way to the other side of the board
Right, sure. I would argue that, though, that we were talking to people. Like, I'm looking at the board here, and we took some pictures that we'll put up on our Instagram page, but we talked to this person here, we talked to this person here, we talked to this person here, which got us the key so that we could get into here. So we talked to everyone on the board except for one person. Unfortunately, we just didn't know there was a certain person that we absolutely had to talk to, and we didn't know that was going
to
happen.
But we did. We knew we had to go back and talk to him.
We kind of thought that maybe it was a possibility that we didn't have to go back.
Let me lay the story down out for those of you listening.
I thought we had to go back.
Yeah.
So we show up at this motel in this ratty New England town in like the 1930s.
And we know the town wants to murder us.
And we know the town wants to murder us. And we're trying to learn about this family.
The Marshes.
The Marshes. Who've been doing some nasty stuff. I took on the role of millionaire Preston Fairmont, and everybody else was who cares, and so basically we're skulking around this town, and things just get real when like a mob starts like carousing around the town trying to find us and like
kill us,
yeah, just murder us,
yeah,
just out in the street,
so that we die forever,
yeah, so earlier. Yeah, so we go crazy and die forever. So we find this FBI agent and he's like, hey, if you guys find a way out of here, come back and get me. And we're like, yeah, okay, sure. We care about you, right?
Yeah, right.
Well, I mean, personally, I was like, this G-man's hiding in a building, not trying to help himself. He can go to the boat on his own. Yeah. I don't care.
Yeah.
Which he did.
Yeah.
Or tried to.
So we do everything we need to do.
Let's be careful to avoid possible spoilers.
Well, yeah, well, I'm just gonna say we're basically this G-man one, like this FBI agent,
he was
ruined the entire endgame for us
in the last 2 days.
He's the reason one of us died. He's the reason two of us went crazy.
Yeah.
He's the reason I couldn't get back on the boat to escape.
Yep.
And it just left Josh just to carry the story of how we saved Massachusetts from Cthulhu.
I made the joke, but I like to think thematically that I'm like looking onto the boat as I'm escaping the town, and I look back and you guys are all just, well, Frank was with me, he was going insane, but I look back and I just see Campbell and Sammi, and their characters are just, they're just laying into the mobs.
Throwing dynamite.
Sammi was throwing dynamite, you know, like those are the kind of moments where I was joking when it's like, you guys were going to get high schools named after you, right? Like you guys were going down swinging to save all of humanity, you know, and there's going to be some casualties along the way. Yeah, it was unfortunate that it was you two, but hey, you guys, Sammi bombed her own spot. She took one for the team to take out as many monsters as she could, and that was badass. That was so cool.
Hey, buddy, I'm Preston Fairmont, millionaire. There's already four high schools named after me.
No, my character is a young star athlete. And she went insane. So my end story, end game, story situation was that she's just on the dock of the boat, or the deck of the boat, just running around in circles.
She's just running in circles.
Can't stop running.
Burning those calories. So I do want to talk about that real quick. I think one of the things that I really like about this game is the mechanic for what happens when you take damage. For those of you who haven't played it, each character has two primary ways that they can take damage. You can either take physical damage, which are reflected by red damage cards, or you can take horror cards, which are blue, which are supposed to be more like the mental, psychotic type of thing. When you say, for example, a character has 7 hit points with the red and 7 hit points with the blue, if you get all 7 hit points with the red or blue a first time, you don't actually die. You're not eliminated from the game. What then happens is you take a permanent status. You either go insane or you become wounded. If you become wounded, it prevents you from doing things like move actions 2 turns in a row. But you can still, you know, you can still participate. You can still contribute and you can continue to play. The thing I think is very, excuse me, I think the thing that's very cool about this game is that if you go insane, there's a very good chance that you will be able to continue playing. You will be able to continue playing, but you will get a possible second objective that is only specific to your character because you've gone insane. And if that victory condition is not met at the end of the game, while the team wins, you don't win per se, because your character just goes insane, which I think is, I think it's a really cool mechanic. Like in most games, when you die, you're dead. And in this game, when you become critically wounded or mentally exhausted, you still get to play. You just have a little bit of a chip on your shoulder for the rest of the game.
Until you it happens again and then you die forever.
Yeah, if it happens twice, you die forever. Forever.
Like continuously, over and over.
Over and over and over and over.
So I like that aspect of the game in one sense. In the other sense, in a cooperative game, it's kind of goofy to have like a condition where it's like, yeah, if you don't do this, you don't win. Because everything you've been working for that entire game, you still like have a sense of accomplishment. So it doesn't really matter that you didn't win. What would make it, I think, more compelling and maybe just more horrible for everybody else is if that card, you turn it over and it goes, you're insane now. Your team can't win if this doesn't happen. And maybe make the things on the insanity cards a little bit less crazy to do.
Sure.
Because my insanity card was literally impossible. Yeah. I mean, it would be possible in certain situations, but like the way you trade items and have to like complete things, it would have taken my character probably 10 more turns.
Yeah.
To complete his insanity in order for him to win. And I just didn't care about that.
Yeah.
I was like, we did it. We won. Who cares about Preston Fairmont? I'm Campbell D'Souza. I win. Like, our team made it.
But you're a millionaire.
Oh, you know what?
He dies a million deaths.
Bury me with my money. I don't care.
Okay. Frank, what'd you think?
I thought that the gameplay of this game, the idea, the theme, I thought it was all just really fantastic. There were definitely bits where like I just really wanted to explore or like check out what was on like in one of the little question marks. I would try to pop over to them, and it was like, you can't explore this. And so I spent several turns where I was just moving and then finding out that I couldn't explore something. And then I was like, well, now I'm so many spots away from being from a different thing that I can explore. So like, so I spent a big part of this game a little bit frustrated with the fact that there wasn't a whole lot that I could do.
Sure.
But then, like everyone else said, when business started to pick up a little bit later on, the story really dragged me in, and I really was enticed by the end game. Yeah, I mean, it's a fun game. I'd totally play it.
Yeah,
again.
Well, and I think thematically, this game is unreal.
I mean, if you're a Lovecraft guy,
even if you're not a Lovecraft guy, I think the stories that it tells, the narratives for the different characters that play out. When I play board games, I like to visualize, like, not just on the board, but like in my head, I'm like, okay, what's actually happening right now? And the idea of our characters are running through these streets while we're being chased by a mob, while buildings are being lit on fire behind us, and we see this boat pull into the distance and we have to sprint to the boat. Like, that's just, it's so cool. This playthrough specifically, I was not on the edge of my seat for the first hour. For the last hour and a half, I was on the edge of my seat the entire time, because the game could have gone either way. I think my favorite thing about playing games with Sammi is you can tell when something happens that she just gets so excited about, because she like jumps up and down in her seat a little bit. And there were times where she was on the verge of dying and it came down to the dice roll, which we'll talk about because I know Frank doesn't like the dice roll, but it came down to a dice roll and it would work. And she would get so excited. It's like, that's awesome. Like there's so many little moments like that that are scattered throughout this game. Like, I know I said this before, I stand by it. This game is easily in my top three, probably my second favorite game of all time. But you know me, I love miniatures. I love a compelling story. I like having physical things that I can move around the board over things like a worker placement, which I do appreciate. But this game, not even being a huge HP Lovecraft fan, has everything that I would want, and I think it does just such a good job at it. And then you add the companion app, which has the really cool, like, off-putting music that
plays
in the background.
Which sucks, because you wouldn't let me put on rap music while we were playing this game.
Of course, why would I?
Because rap music makes every Friday night better. Dude, it's Friday, and next Friday, and the Friday after next.
I hear you. And I do appreciate that, but again, like, this game
Friday.
This game sucks me in. Like, I love playing it, and when we play it, we hook it up to our little Bluetooth speaker that we have, because there's just this really creepy background noise that plays, and there's a song, like a really like just bone-chilling piano line that plays, and there's, you hear glass breaking and doors creaking open and all this cool stuff. And it just hooks me in.
There's like this loud like bell tone that happened at one point, and yeah. I thought it was like a piano key, and I was like, that sounds like the beginning of a Peter, Bjorn, and John song. And I was like, why are we listening to this instead of Peter, Bjorn, and John? that's where I'm at on the companion app sounds.
That's where Campbell's at. But yeah, I'm gonna go back around the table here on the things that we don't necessarily like about this game. I do think there are some things I would like to see done a little differently. But I'm gonna stop talking about how great this game is because I could go on and on and on and on. So I'm gonna start.
Why don't we just make this a four-parter?
We're gonna start with Campbell. And we're going to work our way around here. Campbell, I know you said you like this game. I know you said you felt like it was dragging a bit at the beginning. What are some of the other things about this game that you would maybe caution somebody or make sure that they were aware of if they were wanting to go and buy this game?
I have some pretty simple thoughts about this game. One is in terms of like playing, it's really easy to do, but it's not super approachable for anybody who doesn't want to sit down for a long period of time. It is a two-hour game pretty much at minimum, and could be longer. It's easy to play. It is thematically really good, mechanically awesome, and it's about as good as I think an RPG or like a story game in a box can get, like a cooperative game where you have to complete a mission and search around, and that's cool. I think maybe the only game I've had more fun with in recent years this style is... I mean, I like Mice and Mystics all right,
yeah.
Which is a lot lighter and probably a lot more approachable.
It's cute.
For like a family who wants to play a game like this.
It's a cute game.
Yeah. But the Seventh Continent is really cool.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And I
back that. I filled out my Kickstarter survey today. Mm-hmm. You'll be happy to know I did spend an extra $6 on the Board Game Geek exclusives, where all of the proceeds for those cards, it's 5 extra cards.
Oh, sure.
Go directly to Board Game Geek, and then I also spent like $20 on the player mat, so we'll have a nice 24x24 grid system.
There are a lot of cards in that
game.
Yeah,
there's thousands.
But that's a digression from, I guess, here's the simple thing. I play in a regular tabletop role-playing group. No RPG in a box to me is as compelling as what happens when we do something like that, and here's the reasons why. First of all, I'd like to preface this, what I'm about to say, by saying this is a fantastic game for what it is. And if you want to spend, whatever, $100...
Yeah, it's $100.
To play some nice afternoon-length or evening-length games with some people you don't have a regular like tabletop group with, this is really pretty great. But here's why I would rather play Dungeons and Dragons or any other like role-playing system I've done. This game takes you out of the action as a player constantly, whereas in a tabletop RPG, really the only time you're sitting there waiting is during like a battle. In all of these times with all sorts of stuff going on, you're there in the action, and you have any number of avenues to solve a problem, whereas this game gives you limited options, and there's no problem with that. You know, this game is self-contained in a box with cards, with a companion app, mm-hmm. With a certain number of things you can do. So for somebody who doesn't like a pen and paper RPG, it doesn't necessarily seem limiting. But to a guy like me who does that sort of thing, it seems very limiting. Okay. And I think, Frank, you do that too. So maybe you could speak on that a little bit. Did you feel limited by the things you could do in this game?
Yeah, that's kind of what I was saying a little bit ago. I definitely, you know, you go into a shack and it's like, there's a box in here. You got to have the key. And I'm like, I just used my whole move action to get here. And now there's nothing else I can do with this turn. And like, if I was playing D&D, I'd be like,
or a video game.
I'd
or
be like,
reading a book or you know what I mean?
Yeah. Is there a way I can pick this lock, or is there a way I can smash this box?
Well,
or,
I mean, to that point, I think again, one of the things I'd like to see thematically is, just a couple different ways that certain scenarios could play out. So, for example, there was a situation we found ourselves in this playthrough where we found a really old chain, and it had a lock on it, and we had to find the lock in order to be able to get the chain open. But then at the same time, Frank had an axe. And so it would have been awesome to see a mechanic where it's like, or if you have a heavy weapon, you could try to do a strength roll to see if you could just break the chain, which I know kind of messes up the story that they're trying to tell, because they want you to move around the board and talk to these different people. But I would like to see possible alternate ways for resolving cards based off of the different items, because you get a bunch of items in this game, and so it's all right now it's a 1-to-1 ratio where only one card allows you to do one thing. I would maybe like to see, depending on the card that you have, you might be able to reach the same ultimate goal, but there's a different way that you can go about doing it. Sammi, what do you got?
I don't really have anything bad to say about this game.
Really?
I really like it. You know that.
Yeah. I mean, I know you get
there's not a lot of bad things objectively to say about it, I don't think.
You get frustrated a little bit, which is fair.
I mean, yeah, I get frustrated, but...
We can go back to the dynamite as a perfect example for this. I feel like sometimes Sammi...
I just get stuck on things.
Yeah. Like, there was some dynamite that she had to drop two, three times, and every time she's like, nope, I want my dynamite. We're like, you should probably get out of there because you're being surrounded by monsters, and nope. I want my dynamite. I got to get my dynamite.
Like, the room was on fire and like it spread to the next room. And like, she just kept getting the dynamite knocked out of her hand. And she's like, I got to have that dynamite.
Here's the thing,
and
though.
And it paid off.
Yeah, you did kill a bunch of monsters for us at the end.
Yes.
What Sammi did would have been a subject for applause in a traditional tabletop role-playing game.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And that is where these types of games deviate from the traditional pen and paper role-playing game, in that the idea is really just to create something that's memorable and have a good time following the rules of a game and creating stories based on it. You're rewarded for acting in your character's best interest according to them, instead of acting in your character's best interest according to the game.
Sure.
Here we have an objective, and it's a one-off, so if we don't act as game players, you know, for our characters, they don't succeed. But in a tabletop RPG, if you act like your character, whether or not you win or lose the day, you've succeeded.
There's definitely times where, like, in this game where someone learned some information that was relevant to giving us what we needed, like where we needed to be. And we all just played like, yeah, we know what we have to do next.
Yeah.
And I play in Cam's tabletop D&D group on Mondays,
and I would take away experience points from him if he metagamed like that.
I would sit there and go, well, I mean, I know this thing, but does my character know this thing? Sure. No, this is what my character would do in this situation.
And again, I think we have to remind ourselves, this is a, you know, this is a board game.
Yeah,
it's a cooperative board game. While it does push some of the limits, I would say, on what a tabletop story driven board game can be, to your point, it is not D&D, and it never will be.
None of these are complaints. These are just unpacking, I think, the game in a like a thematic perspective.
Sure.
Just trying to kind of process like the story of the game versus like the game of the game.
So let's talk about the thematic for a second, because that kind of hints on. So I like I said, I love this game. I really only have one big gripe with this game, and I apologize. I might cough as we get through this. I've been getting over some chest congestion, so appreciate you all bearing with me. My biggest gripe with this game is when we sit down and we're saying, okay, what storyline do we want to play? I would love to see a functionality within the app that allows you to select or adjust the difficulty for the different storylines that you want to play.
Absolutely.
It drives me crazy that if we want to play a 2 out of 5, like if I wanted to play a light game with you guys tonight, there was really only one option for us. And that option is the shortest option. It all, like, I would love to see something where you could change the, like, within the 4 or 5 starting storylines, you could change the length and things are added or taken away as you do, and then you can also change the difficulty, because then you're able to play multiple storylines. Like, we didn't want to play the 2 out of 5 star campaign tonight because Sammi, Campbell, and I had all already played that, and we said, okay, well, let's play the Escape from Innsmouth one. There were 3 others to choose from, but they were all either too hard or way too long.
No, they were all just too long. We would have played the hardest one we could have, you know, for the purposes of this podcast, if it was an hour and a half. The what this game could really benefit from in a next edition is you set, and this would be so cool to me, and I don't know, like, logistically what it would take, because I'm just not a programmer. That's and I'm not a game designer, but if you could just tap the app and go, how long do you want to play for? 2 hours. What difficulty level do you have? 4. And then it's like, okay, creating scenario.
Yeah.
And maybe it would choose from one of five scenarios for you. You could choose one of five scenarios.
And then it would just, like, spawn just, different yeah, just, bad guys.
It would just be random enough for you where, yeah.
And again, the pieces change, right? The like we've played this one before unsuccessfully, but when we played it tonight, certain items were in different spots. Certain characters were in different spots. We didn't necessarily run into the same people that we ran into the last time, but it still drives me crazy that if I had, like, my family was coming over and we decided to play Mansions of Madness and we're playing with my mom, and so we're going to play the most basic one. It really drives me crazy that I'm limited to one option, because if I continue to do that, I'm literally just going to play that one version over and over and over and over again. So I would love to see something that, to your point, you say, okay, what difficulty do you want to play at and how long do you want to play for? And then they do a collection or assortment or however you want to say it of the five storylines that they have to kind of put something together, and then you go from there. So... Yeah. I feel like while the companion app is phenomenal, I feel like it is a bit limiting, because there are only five stories that you can play. There's a little bit of variety within it, but not enough that it's going to feel like a brand new experience every single time. and yeah, that's really my only gripe, which is not a huge complaint. Like, I would gladly play any of the campaigns that they have or any of the scenarios. That's just if I were to pick out something, I would pick out that one thing.
Actually, if I were really to truly pick out a con for this game, is I would say, based on the five scenarios in this game, you have, what, 15 hours of gameplay? 15 hours of new-to-you gameplay, and then you got to buy Expansions of Madness to get more scenarios. And this is a $100 game.
It is. And the new expansion that just came out is $60.
Yeah, and I mean, like, even Betrayal at House on the Hill, there's 50 haunts. I mean, think about that. You play all 50 of those things and you play an hour, that's 50 hours of gameplay for $45. And seriously, if you're in love with that game and you start at haunt 1 and you go to haunt 50, and it doesn't quite work like that because you kind of randomize it, but by the time you've played 50, you're probably ready to go back and play some of your favorite haunts again.
Yeah.
And then there's a whole new book of 50 new haunts.
Yeah.
That's 50 times. This is 5 times for $100.
Yeah.
Which is, I mean... That's a little weak. It's for me, it's like buying a, you know, like an Assassin's Creed game to get like a 10-hour campaign.
Right.
And I don't like really play Assassin's Creed, and I think their campaigns are longer than that. But you know what I'm saying? Like any like AAA action game with like a 10-hour campaign in it versus like I'll buy Spelunky for $15 and play it 150 times.
Sure. So, okay. Well, yeah. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I think that makes sense. Like I said, I think we can all agree this game has a lot of good stuff going for it. There are some things that we maybe would want to see change.
Man, I'm straight going against what I said in like episode 2 or whatever. Like replayability is a factor, I guess, for this one.
Yeah, replayability 100% is a factor for this one. I think the replayability is great, all things considered, and I will gladly buy all of the expansions that come out. I own a few of them, which we decided not to play tonight for the purposes of the podcast. But some of the additional stories have new characters, have new enemies, have new stories that they add. The one other thing that brings up a good point. The one thing I thought that was really cool is you tell the app when you buy an expansion, and so even though we played one of the base storyline or one of the base scenarios tonight, because it knows that I have the expansion, it did have us pull in some monsters from the other expansions, which it didn't break the game. Like you don't necessarily have to have that, but I just thought that was a really cool touch.
I do also really like the story-driven aspects of combat.
Yeah.
How combat is app driven.
Yep.
And so every time you make an attack, it kind of gives you a different situation.
Mm-hmm.
Which to me does add theme to the game. It's like, hey, this time when you shoot the gun, this happens.
Yeah.
This time when you cast a spell, there's a different effect.
Yep.
And that's cool. That really is a good idea from these guys.
So I'm going to take it over to Samantha for a segment that we're going to try to do a little bit of a better job at going forward. One of the things that we really wanted to make sure to talk about is who do we think this is a good game for? As you've probably picked up, Campbell, Frank, and I all have really different opinions when it comes to board games. But we want to have an honest conversation about the type of person or the type of gamer that we think this board game would be a good or logical fit for. Sammi, as the she's shaking her head no, like, don't bring this to me, but as the more or less non-gamer at the table, who do you think would enjoy this game? Do you think this is a game that every person would like? Do you think this is a game that only certain people would like? What do you think?
The first person that comes to mind would be my mom's husband, Adam. he's super into like sci-fi and mysteries. So I don't know if he plays many board games, mm-hmm. but he would be someone I would play with.
Okay. Is there anyone that comes to mind that you would probably not play this game with or not recommend this game to? Like, I know we joked earlier, Amy and Jessica only play Disney games, but is this the kind of game that you would potentially ask them to play or no?
Jessica, maybe, because she is more into gaming.
She loves Skyrim.
She does. She lives for Skyrim, and I just found out she recently started playing Assassin's Creed, and she's like obsessed with The Sims.
Oh, that's too bad.
So
is that too bad?
I hate The Sims.
Sims is kind of cool. Like, I've never really gotten into it, but I understand its merits.
All right,
I want to weird simulators are cool.
I would want to take a poll for The Sims and say, if you played The Sims, did you actually like the game, or did you just build the swimming pool and then remove the ladder to get out of the swimming pool and then fast forward it to see how long it would take before your Sim drowned to death?
Those are the people who like...
Because I definitely did that.
Those are the people who like just kill civilians in Grand Theft Auto instead of doing the missions.
I just used the cheat code to get like millions of dollars.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, yeah. You use the Preston Fairmont cheat code?
Yes.
Yeah. Frank, let's kick it over to you.
Hey, I'm Preston Fairmont. Shuffle off, buddy. 23 Skidoo.
Who do you think this game is a good fit for?
So I guess one of the things that kind of stuck out to me right at the beginning of this game was no one told me any rules. We just laid it out on the table and we're just like, hey, okay, who's going first?
So I'm
going
to interrupt quickly. Campbell said when we were starting this game that one of the things that's great about it is you can teach as you go and you'll pretty much be able to pick it up. Did you agree with that?
100% agree. And okay. that's what I'm getting at is that you don't have to be like a person who plays really complex games. Like, I don't think you have to be a hardcore gamer to get into this game because I was just like, okay, so why don't someone else go first and I will just jump in. And I did, and I didn't ever feel like I missed a beat. So this game is not for people who absolutely hate horror games, or horror themed anything.
Yeah.
And that's about it. I think that I would, if I had this game, I would play it with just about anybody.
We all were into like the idea of this game. This game has more moving parts than I think register with us playing, because Sammy, you've played this game 3 or 4 times. You've played a couple other games like this. Frank, Josh, me, we play board games all the time. You got like 5 or 6 cards sitting in front of you that I think there's a trap all the time for people who don't play a lot of games to go, oh no, I forgot that I could do this and I could have done that like 3 turns ago and now I'm upset.
Mm-hmm.
I forgot that I have this special ability that my character can use. I forgot that I shouldn't go in there because I have this trait whatever. This game is very accessible, but the time limit and the theme make it a little bit more of a game that you'd want to kind of say, hey, this is what we're getting into when we do this.
Would you say that if you're a bit squeamish, this game may give you nightmares?
No.
I would.
I think there's no chance of a nightmare happening because of this game.
When it tells me that the mob kicks out their weaklings and beats them to death in front of me, like, I'm going to have a nightmare about that. I picture it. I see it now, and it's terrifying.
I'm not.
Well, yeah, because you guys lack imagination like I do, apparently. But, you know, that's neither here nor there. Anyway, let's move on to let's give this a score. I'll start. I think this game's a 10. This is, like I said, this game's in my top 3, so it shouldn't surprise anyone that I'm giving arguably my second favorite game of all time a 10 out of 10. I think I love it. I would play it anytime that anyone asks me to. I think it's great. Sammy, we're going to throw it over to you. What do you think? Scale of 1 to 10, where does this game fall for you? Knowing it's currently rated an 8.2.
Okay. I think I will give it a 9.
Ooh.
And it's mostly for personal reasons because, like we talked about earlier, I tend to get stuck on things. And this kind of happened when we were playing Pandemic Legacy a couple nights ago, too. I get a plan stuck in my head, and I want to do that because, to me, it sounds like the easiest and the best way to accomplish something.
Mm-hmm.
And so I got stuck in that room forever. And like you said, I kept having to drop my dynamite, but I really wanted it. And I think if I would not have been so stuck on that, things would have ended differently.
Yeah.
I love the storyline payoff, though. I really liked that.
Yeah.
I was pumped
again
up.
I love the idea of we're like sailing off into like the murky sea, and we look back behind us and Sammy's just like, go on without me.
You know,
she's throwing dynamite and shooting down the mob. Like, that's awesome.
Something I like about this game is you generally have to do a fair amount of investigating before you're able to like go do the end of the game. One of the things that I'm kind of sad about that I felt like has been an issue in the three different scenarios I played in this game is it doesn't get you too wrapped up in the actual details of what you're trying to investigate. Generally, the game comes to be about like, oh, you have enough information, now go fight the boss or go escape or whatever. And that's where the drama happens. I would like to see a little bit more, I guess, drama surrounding the actual thing you're investigating.
Well, in a couple of the scenarios, it was more like that. Like the time that we...
Oh, you're right. Yeah,
we investigated, and remember we had to go up into the attic,
yeah,
and it was the cults. They
that
had
was
like
what
their
we were investigating.
Seance.
And then we had to go like defeat them. And was cool, yeah. And I kind of forgot about that.
That one was more interesting than this one.
Yeah, and I would say also on that, one of the expansion storylines that we play is a dinner party.
Expansions of Madness.
And you're trying to figure out who is trying to murder the host of the dinner party. And so, you know, and so
I didn't do that one.
Yeah,
I
know, that's what I'm saying.
That
sounds cool. So you're moving around and you're interviewing. There's multiple party guests and you're talking to all of the party guests.
Oh, that sounds
trying
fun.
To figure out what the motives are. And then suddenly the lights go black. And you have to figure out very quickly who's trying to murder the host. Otherwise, you know, it goes sideways. But I would say there are, and again, this goes back to, there are multiple stories that you can play, especially if you buy all of the expansions, and they all have something.
Of Madness.
Yeah, the Expansions of Madness, as Campbell likes to say.
I just think that sounds so funny.
Expansions. Expansions.
Expansions, yeah, of Schmadness. They all have something a little bit different. One of the storylines that we played, which I thought was so cool, and again, I don't want to go into too much of the detail to leave something for folks to discover as they play this, but in one of the games, you go into the house, and then halfway through, like, the whole house starts rearranging itself, and so you're playing, and you're having to constantly, like, you're over here, and then you're over here, and then you get moved over here, and then half of the house just disappears into the nether realm.
I forgot about that one too. That was smart. Yeah.
Yeah. So there's a bunch of really cool mechanics. Like I said, this game is awesome. It's a 10 out of 10 for me. You didn't give it a score, so I'm going to go back to you, Campbell. If you had to give this game a score, what would you give it?
Yeah. Okay. So if I'm talking like objectively, like what I really do think this game deserves, in terms of like how it stacks up against all of the other board games of all time, I think it's well put together. I think this is a really solid choice for anybody who likes this style of game. So for what it is in the top of its class. I 100% agree with that. I would say that 20, if I was giving an objective review of like the best 100 games, I'd probably put it a little lower, probably in the 30s or 40s. Not due to its, like thematics or whatever, probably just because I feel like the game lacks long-standing value in that there'll probably be something that comes out that replaces this, maybe by the same manufacturer, maybe by the next edition of this game. This game isn't to me, like a Puerto Rico or a Castles of Burgundy or a game that in and of itself stands the test of time. I think this is a genre that is constantly being bettered by new editions and new games. So if I was going to give it a number, I'd say 7.8 to 8 would probably be about where I'd put it.
So, yeah, I think I also would give it an 8. I think it's pretty. I think it's fun. I really liked the gameplay mechanics.
All right. So we like the game, it sounds like. Frank gave it an 8. You gave it an 8. Sammy gave it a 9. I gave it a 10. It's a great game. Go buy it. If you don't have it, go get it. Anyway, Sammy, who do you have to plug?
Nobody. Brush your teeth, eat your vegetables, be kind to one another.
Campbell?
Today I want to plug the stuff I listened to on Spotify this afternoon. So for those of you out there who are looking at listening to some jams that Cam likes, I spent some time listening to a fairly recent live album by like Afrobeat slash like jazz group, jazz, hip hop, jazz. I don't know. Probably like mostly Afrobeat. Emefe, E-M-E-F-E. Very, very cool. Very fun music.
What about you, Frank? Who do you got to plug this week?
As usual, I'm going to plug every single person who has followed us on our social media, Facebook, The Board Boys Podcast, Instagram, at The Board Boys Podcast, Twitter, at The Board Boys Pod. Everyone who's checking us out on iTunes, click and subscribe. Checking us out on Google Play Music, SoundCloud, and Stitcher. Like, I know I say it and just drive the point home like every single time that we put out an episode, but like, we just really appreciate everybody who, is listening and giving us great feedback, and talking about us to your friends. I know I've talked to some of my friends who have said, hey, I told people at my church group from Iowa State about you, and they told me they listened to you. So I love hearing that, and it means a lot to us.
Weren't you saying something cool happened on our Instagram page actually today?
This question sounds like a slam dunk.
This question is a slam dunk because, as a matter of fact, this is a thing that did happen. Apparently 103 people slammed that follow button on Instagram, and they're checking out all of our behind the scenes photos on the gram. And we, like I said, we super appreciate that. Yeah, like, keep them coming.
So I'm going to piggyback off of what you just said there, Frank. We've been making some great friends on Instagram and Twitter. We've been getting some genuinely constructive criticism via our email, Board Boys Podcast.
And constructivism too. Like, people are being like super, super nice. We had no idea, like, seriously, that people would be so jazzed on this. And we're just want to say thank you so much.
Yeah.
So, and please just continue to tell us what it is you want to hear, because that's why we're doing this. We want to talk about board games, and we want to spread the word on these top 100 games, because when you're trying to build a board game collection, it's really hard to know what to buy, and we know these games are good objectively.
Are you setting me up for like the perfect segue here?
I don't know.
Perfect segue.
We know these games are good objectively. That's not what we're trying to determine. We want you guys to be able to listen to this and say, oh, I think I would like Clank. I think I would like Eclipse. I think based on what these guys are saying, it's worth it to take a shot on these or look more into it. And that's, so if there's stuff you want to hear about, let us know.
Yeah. And to piggyback off of what Campbell had just said, if you are interested in adding Mansions of Madness to your collection, be sure to follow us on Facebook. I think one of the things we've been having a lot of internal conversations about the last couple weeks is, you know, we want to give back to the community, and we want to give back to the folks that are listening to us, and was offering up a board game randomly from Campbell's collection.
Really, and taking that 3-game hit just devastated me.
I know. But is that really a great, you know, a great way to give back? And we said, you know what? We're going to kick things up a notch. So we're partnering with a local board game shop here in Iowa called Arkham Games. Shout out to John over there. He's doing some great things. But
yeah, John is the man. I spend a lot of time over there, and I get to chat with him pretty frequently. His shop is fantastic. He's got a spot to play. He does a lot of like miniatures, Magic the Gathering, tabletop RPGs, has a great selection of consistently like popular, but also like new hotness board games. And he can also order pretty much whatever you want.
Yep.
And he does do a discount for folks who order, from him if they order something specific. So, super great guy and an awesome little shop.
We're all coughing and just time of year.
You guys,
it is that.
You can cough, but don't scoff. John's the man.
No, John is incredible. And again, we really wanted to sort of kick it up a notch in the contest that we were offering, making it worthwhile for you all. And so, you know, follow us on Facebook. Check us out. We will be giving away a free copy of Mansions of Madness in celebration of the new episode. You can get all of the details on our Facebook page. We're keeping things real simple. I know in the last few contests, we've, you know, added a layer of give us your best name for a winery or for D&D Vin Diesel character. But you can check out all of the details over on our Facebook page. Like I said, we're going to keep things pretty straightforward, I think, going from here on out. Like us on Facebook. Share the status when you see it get posted. And it will be going up the day after this episode goes live, so that'll be up that Friday, and that's it. You like us on Facebook, you share it, anything else, if you want to give us 5 stars on iTunes, you know, rate us on the Facebook page, that's all great. But all you have to do to be considered to win is to like us on Facebook and share that status. And you got a shot at winning a free copy of Mansions of Madness. So
whatever prohibitive, some restrictions apply.
See store for details, blah, blah, blah. Anyway.
Huge shout out to Sammi for being such a sport and hanging out with us so late.
Sammy's been an absolute champion. And I'm not just saying that because she is my rock and my world. And my everything. She's like gagging,
over
here.
Choking down,
vomit. Find another lover sweeter than you.
Love you, babe.
Sweeter than you.
And
I can never find another lover. Just keep going. Precious than you. The outro. More precious than you. Here, do you want me to go?
Keep going.
Close to me, you're like my mother. Close to me, you're like my father. Close to me,
we're the board boys.
Close to me, you're like my brother.
We hope you like board games.
You are the only one for me. Yeah. And for you, the song I sing all my life. I pray for someone like you. And I thank God that I finally found you. All my life, I pray for someone like you. And I hope that you feel the same way. Are you going to do the harmony or am I going to do the harmony? And I hope that you feel the same way too.